Yesterday, one of the YS students asked me a question. He asked me, if my friends ask me for scientific proof for yoga, what should I say? They ask for proof, what should I say? I told him, first you ask those friends of yours who are asking for scientific proof, what is scientific method? They won't know. Whenever some concept becomes too popular, like yoga, like science, they become extremely distorted also. Common people think that scientific proof is like some banana which can be shown to you. They think it's like showing a banana and you will see the proof right away. It is not so easy. Even in science, experimentation and evidence comes in the last step, not in the first step. Of course, in science, a few people, a certain group of people are willing to do that process for you. So you yourself don't have to go to a lab and do it. This is called objective verifiability. Objective verifiability means three people can sit and look at the same thing, it will be the same. It won't vary for three people. So it is objectively present. So yes, in science, the advantage is that a certain group of people, we can allocate the job to a certain group of people. They can do all the work for us, they can do the hypothesis observation and then verifying it, whether it is true or not. They can do all the work and then they can tell us that it was found to be true or false. Actually, most of the people simply go by faith. When scientist tells us something, we go by faith, we don't know head and tail. If suppose a quantum physics physicist comes and shows you proof on the screen, theoretical proof for something, will we understand head and tail of it? We will see some symbols, that's all. We won't understand what it is. And even if they show you experimental proof, if they show you some double slit experiment or something, some complicated stuff, you will see, but you won't know how to interpret it. You won't know the proof yourself unless you are willing to undergo the process of learning yourself first. So it is not simply showing a banana to you and see this is the proof. It is not like that even in science. The person who is seeing the proof should have some eligibility first to understand the proof. Even in science, there is some subjective element involved. Subjective means there has to be some eligibilities on the perception of the observer also matters. Whether they have some capability or not matters there also. But yes, most of the job is objective in science. Actually, science is basically objective. It works on objective verifiability. The other point people do not realize about science, when they ask for scientific proof of everything, they don't consider the possibility of science having a limitation. Science has limitations. Science is not God. The scientific method has limitations of its own. See, for example, if I tell you, if you eat fresh vegetables, fresh fruits, without allowing them to remain for a long time after you pluck them, if you eat fresh, it has some positive impact on your system. If I tell you, you may ask, okay, where is the proof for it? The objective proof that you are looking for, scientific proof, what chemical change will happen in the body, what better things will happen in the body, that proof may come, but it may take 40, 50 years. It is not a small job to come up with an objective proof for this, because the system is highly complicated. If you are willing to wait for 40, 50 years, it may come about. Very clearly, what is the difference if you eat fresh vegetable immediately after you pluck? What is the impact on the body? And if you keep it for like 2-3 days and then you eat, what is the impact? If you eat packed food, what is the impact? In yoga, we say that once it cross is a certain number of hours, there is no life in it. It is dead. The food is dead. There may be calories in it, but there is no life in it. It won't give you liveliness, what we call a sattvic food. It may give you some energy. Energy means it will give you calories to perform your work, but it will not give you liveliness. That's what yoga says, that's what Ayurveda says. Now if you ask for scientific proof for this, and if you say, I will not accept until you give me scientific proof, okay, it may come about in 40-50 years. It may come about. It will take a long time for objective proof to come. So if you are willing to wait for 40-50 years, you wait. But the simpler thing to do is, you eat it for a week and see yourself, can't you sense that much? You have a body of your own. You eat food every day. Instead of eating that, eat this. That's all. We are not asking you to commit some murder or robbery. We are just asking you to change the food. Instead of waiting for 40 years, if you yourself change your diet, if you have exploratory mind, you will do it. This is self-experimentation. This is subjective verifiability. It is subjectively verifiable. Objective verifiability may take decades to come, yes. But subjectively it is verifiable within few days. If you are willing to eat it and see it yourself, how it is making you feel, everybody can test it. Eat, not even a week. Just for 2-3 days, continuously eat fresh vegetables and fruits. You see how you will feel on the third day. You will feel extremely fresh, you will feel tranquil. Agitation will be less, restlessness will be less. Your efficiency of work will be more, everything will increase. You will see it yourself. In 3 days you can do it. Instead of doing this, if you say, I want scientific proof for doing this, it is idiocy. It is not intelligent. A final proof may come, objective proof may come, somebody in the lab may prove, yes, the chemicals in the body, this will happen, that will happen in the body, your body will work better. They may prove it in the lab, but this is not a small thing to do in the lab. It will take to do one experiment and prove something. Sometimes a century passes by. Just for your information, when quantum physics came about, when all these Heisenberg, Einstein were debating, the debate did not conclude in their time, in their lifetime. The proof came in the 1980s. Poor people, they debated only in their life. Theoretical proof was there for it, fine. They were debating theoretically what is the best, but experimental proof came in the 1980s. So yes, in science that's a limitation. For experiment to happen, you need certain technological advancement. And it may not be possible to do it in your time. So in case of quantum physics, you cannot do anything, you have to wait, yes. But in case of subjective matters, if you say I will wait for objective proof, it is unintelligent. You can simply do it yourself and see the results first hand, instead of waiting for some scientist to do it for you. 30-40 years ago, if some yogi said, breathe in a particular pattern, do this Nadi Shuddhi Pranayama, or breathe slowly, or whatever, if he said, if you asked, show me scientific proof. There was no proof for 40 years ago, nobody had conducted any experiment. They did not do any random control trial or nothing 40 years ago. So 40 years ago, there was no medical proof or any scientific proof for that. If you breathe slowly, it is very good for the system. There was no proof. So if you said at that time, if you said, okay, until proof comes, I will not do, who is the loser? 40 years, after 40 years, the proof will come. In those 40 years, you did not do it waiting for the proof. Who is the loser? After 40 years, you may not be even able to do it. So like that in yoga, in case of, not just yoga, in case of all bodily aspects, starting from food, breathing, and all these hatha yoga practices and everything, if you say, show me proof, only then I will do, it is an unintelligent thing to do. The proof will take a long time to come. The proof that you are looking for, objective proof, will take a long time to come. And by the time it comes, you may be dead actually. Or you may be extremely... The body may be extremely old. You may not be able to do them. This happened with food industry. It is happening even now with food industry. Everything they are trying to prove objectively. And therefore, diet industry is going mad. The diet industry is literally going mad. Something that can be easily done through the body is subjective verifiability. You can simply, if you are a little sensitive, the body will tell you what is best for it. You don't have to sit and debate over what is best. You don't have to debate over any types of this non-veg, veg or whatever is happening in this food industry, whether this soil is better or that is better. You don't have to sit and bang your head intellectually and come to a conclusion. Actually, you cannot come to a conclusion intellectually because it is so complex. The system is so complex. If you try to objectively come to a conclusion with this, this will, I don't know how long it will take, probably it will never happen. Because this is an infinitely complex machine. The food itself is infinitely complex. Two complex machines are interacting and you are trying to come up with a conclusion in a lab. Instead of that, simply, if you are simply sensitive enough to your body will tell which food is best for it. If you are sensitive, if you make some observations yourself, the body will tell what is best for it. You don't have to wait for anybody else. So this diet industry is anyway going crazy. In fact, the diet industry itself, if you look at it, it is an unnecessary industry. Now it has grown to such an extent you cannot take it away. But no other animal on the planet has diet lessons, diet industry. All animals are very, very healthy without a diet lesson. Because we made it intellectual, because we made something which is the realm of the body, brought it to the realm of the intellect. Things are going extremely crazy. We are looking for proof for everything. So if people were sensitive enough to their own body sensations, what the body is saying, food can be resolved very easily within a few weeks or months. The body can resolve the food matters very easily. But we have become so insensitive. We don't know what we are eating also. Forget about what the food will do after. We don't even know what we are eating, while we are eating. We don't know how it is digesting, whether the stomach is happy with that food or not. We don't sense that. Whether the body is fine with that after the digestion, whether we are feeling pleasant or not, we don't sense, we don't try to observe any of that. We are simply trying to live like a machine with calorie theory. Calorie theory means it's a machine theory. If you are this height, this weight, you need this much fuel. We are going by that machine theory. Getting rid of all the personal sensations that you can go about. And then therefore it has become so complex, we have become insensitive to the simpler things of our own body, and therefore somebody else has to tell us now, you have to drink 2-3 liters of water every day. Couldn't you have simply listened to your throat? Why is there a thirst mechanism in the body? Finally, that's what they are saying, you know, after doing lot of headbanging in the lab, finally, scientists are telling, drink when you are thirsty. To tell this, did you have to spend $1 billion? Finally, they are coming to that only. There is no strict guideline for drinking water. It can vary from season to season, it will vary from person to person, it will vary from your situation. So, you observe your thirst sensation and drink accordingly. This is the final conclusion that they are arriving at slowly. Eat when hungry, drink when thirsty. Animals have to laugh at us, really. After simpler things which could have been, which intellect did not even have interfered with, we need not have brought intellect into picture at all. We brought intellect, made it so complex, and we thought we are doing very sophisticated stuff. We were actually doing idiotic stuff, and we thought we were doing very intelligent stuff, thinking we were doing scientific stuff. Then we spent a lot of money, a lot of effort. Then we tried to bring out a rule, you have to drink 2 liters of water every day. Then they found this is not true, because in every season the situation is different. And climate will matter, where you are will matter, your body composition will matter. So many things will come into play. It is not a strict, you are not a machine. Human beings are not machines. That if you are 6 feet high and this much weight, you have to drink this much water every day. It is not a machine. There are so many subjective aspects. But because human beings became insensitive to their own thirst mechanism, then somebody else came and told, you are not drinking enough water, you have to drink 2 liters water. They did not tell because it is 2 liters you have to drink. They told because you stopped drinking also. You are so busy in your computer all day, that you even ignored your thirst mechanism and you drank less water, you went into problems, and therefore some other doctor from outside had to tell you now, you have to drink water, you have to drink more water. So all the subjective aspects were converted into objective aspects, and therefore we are suffering that now. So in yoga in general, starting with food, it has to be more subjective and less objective. Yes, you can do some objective research, I'm not negating it completely. Some objective stuff you can do with food and breathing and whatever, fine, no problem. But it has now become predominantly objective, that is the problem. It should be predominantly subjective. If you are willing to go through the process, you will see the effects, you will see the, you will make the observations, you will make the experiment, you will make the conclusions very quickly. You don't have to wait for 30, 40 years. So, whenever we come to this yoga and subjective aspects like this, and if you ask for proof beforehand, it is not the right approach, because science works with objective verifiability, whereas when it comes more and more closer to the body, like food and whatever takes you to positive health, they are more and more subjective. There is subjective verifiability. This is one fundamental confusion that people are today in. They think that science is verifiability and this traditional things are, we have to go by faith. No, you don't have to go by faith. It is subjectively verifiable. There is verifiability there. Science and modern scientific things and the traditional things are objective verifiability versus subjective verifiability. Both are verifiable in different ways. Don't think that only these things are verifiable, this is only faith. This is not only faith. This is subjectively verifiable. So the distinction lies in that it is objective, this is subjective. So don't confuse yoga to be something that you have to go by faith. No, you don't have to go by faith. Something will be told to you and it is up to you to explore it on your own. If you are willing to do it for a week or two, you will see it yourself. But now, in today's time, so much of objective data has gathered for yoga. It is there. If you are unwilling to do subjective verification, initially some objective verification has to be given. Yes, some experiment has been done. They noted these changes in the body. Therefore, we have found that it is beneficial to give you some conviction to begin with. So there, so much of data has emerged in the last 30, 40 years. Here and elsewhere also, they had even found that if you walk 30 minutes a day, if you breathe properly, your genetic expressions also change, your telomeres will grow, your aging will reverse. So many things have found now. Objective proof is there for that. Even here they have found, they have genetic expression lab, some machines here to check that. They found just in two weeks of staying in Prashanthi Kutir and going through this routine, doing some asana pranayama practice, doing some Krida Yoga, playing games, happy assembly, just going through that routine for 2 weeks, changed their gene expressions. This is magic. In 20 years ago, somebody told this, they will not believe this. They will tell you are talking rubbish. Today, there is objective proof for this. So if you are not sensitive enough to sense that you are feeling good, actually, when a person feels good, that the first person to see that is that himself, that something good is happening, I am feeling good. But what to do now? Machines have to tell us that we are feeling good. That yes, something good is happening in the body, so you have to feel good now. So yes, you start there because we have become so insensitive. We will do some test on your body and we will tell you, yes, your body likes pranayama. You have to do pranayama. The pranayama is suiting the body. Your system likes this. It is going towards positive health. You may not be feeling anything, but your body will be. If you are sensitive enough, you will feel yourself. But since we are not sensitive enough, okay, presently we will begin with a machine. A machine will tell you, yes, you are feeling good. Your body is feeling good. Your genes are changing. Your genes are changing. Forget about the superficial physiological variables. Your genetic expressions are changing. Molecular level it is changing. Another thing is they found is around 15-20 years ago, until then they were saying that up till the age of 25 or something, neuron regrowth happens, neuron growth happens, gray matter grows. After that, after a particular age, neuron regrowth doesn't happen. If it is killed, it doesn't grow again. They found that also to be false now. If you do right things, your neuronal regeneration also happens. So whatever you call as degenerative, there is opposite proof for that now. The only degeneration is not the only thing. If you are willing to do the right things, even neural regeneration happens. They found, if you are interested, you can see, this was done by a man called Dean Ornish. They found, he and his team, they found, just by changing diet, just by doing some minimum physical activity, they did it in the US, because there people don't even walk for 30-40 minutes a day. Everything is done by car. So they made those people walk 30-40 minutes a day and they changed their diet. Just because of that, they found their brain size increased measurably, few micrometers or millimeters or whatever, meaning neuron regeneration happened to such an extent that brain size increased. And here we were telling earlier that neuron generation doesn't happen after a particular age. No, it happens. Everything can happen. If you are willing to do the right thing, if you are willing to be in tune with the system will go towards positive health. You don't have to do any special things. So subjectively, if you are willing to do, verifiability will happen. You don't have to do. Starting maybe, when you start, yes, there is blindness, you don't know whether it will happen or not. You are starting with some faith, yes, but verification will happen very soon. Subjective verification will happen very, very soon. So instead of doing that, if you wait for objective verification, your whole lifetime may go away. And then you may regret, oh, I could have simply done this myself. The same thing happened one day, I think I'll tell Avinash. 10 or 12 years ago, they said, somebody did something in the lab and said, ghee is not good. And all these Indians simply accepted it without thinking for a minute. We have been eating ghee for thousands of years. If you simply stop it, it is idiotic. We have been eating, this is in Ayurveda, it is a Nitya Rasayana, we have to eat it every day. Maybe yes, so many corruption has happened now, all this milk controversy and all, fine. But simply negating it just because somebody did some research was idiotic. People did that, or the Indian supermodern was just did that. They stopped ghee completely, then after 10 years, the same scientists or a different group of scientists, I don't know, they said, no, ghee is good. You will feel like an idiot now. 10 years you stopped ghee. Now who is accountable for it? They said ghee is good. After 10 years, the same people said ghee is good. You have to eat. It is good. Now, for 10 years you did not eat. Now who is responsible for this? Same thing happened with coconut oil. First they said coconut oil is bad, it will give you heart disease. Now they are using coconut oil to treat heart disease. This diet industry will make you go crazy. Therefore, use some common sense. If something has been happening for thousands of years, if it is part of your culture, simply don't brush it aside because some Harvard University told some nonsense about it. It has been part of the culture, and if coconut oil really gave heart disease, Kerala must have gone extinct by now. Because they are dipped in coconut oil whole day. So just because some research comes, simply go down the... Just because you see the word science, don't get brainwashed. There is so much of corruption there also. So, anyway, just remember this one thing, when you ask for proof, it is not about proof or faith, it is about objective verifiability and subjective verifiability. Yoga and these food aspects are subjectively verifiable if you are willing to go through it. If you are lazy, if you don't want to do the exploratory process yourself, then yes, you have to wait for 30-40 years, it will come. The choice is up to us, but don't confuse science versus yoga as verifiability versus faith. No, yoga is not faith, yoga goes by subjective verifiability. Thank you. Om Asato Ma Sargamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Vrityorma Mridangamaya.